Well, howdy, everybody. I am Arthur Morris, Birds is Art, and sometimes I ask the question from a chorus line, does the man make the music, or does the music, not from a chorus line, anybody know that one? Does the man make the music, or does the music make the man? A way oldie, they're playing our song. The story of the real life romance of Burt Bacharach and Carol Bear Sager. Anyway, does the man make the pictures, or do the pictures make the man? And I think for me, it's sort of a combination of the two. This August 7th, how many days ago was that, like three, four? Was 33 years since I bought my first lens, the old Canon 400 millimeter EF 4.5 manual focus lens, started crawling around the mud in Jamaica Bay. It's been a while. Anyway, how many people own a 600? How many people own a 500? How many people own an 800? It's a great lens, boy. It's the one lens that I miss every once in a while. And looking at getting ready for the show and seeing the pictures with the old 800 going, boy, oh boy. How many people ever own the manual focus 800? Had you focused in the back? Minimum focusing distance was 45 feet. Total insanity. Anyway, we're here today to talk about teleconverters. How many people use the 2X on their super telephoto lens all the time without a problem? Yeah, that's why we're doing this program. How many people use their 1.4 all the time without much of a problem? A little bit better. Okay, you'll rarely see me with a big lens without a teleconverter, and most of the time I'm going to have the 2X on. Now, these are not my in-the-field clothes. I actually had my shirt ironed today. I think it might be like 30 or 40 years since I had a shirt ironed, because usually if I have an occasion, I just go and buy a shirt. But I bought this to go see Jersey Boys last week, and it was all wrinkled, so we ironed it this morning. But when I am in the field, you'll see me with this really expensive fanny pack. It's not a photo pack, it just costs about $1.99. But it's really super helpful for me. I'm sure for like $49 you could get one here that's padded, but this does great for me, and I try to never go without it, because what I have inside are my 2X and my 1.4 teleconverters, the subject of today's program. So, Nikon makes a 1.7X also, and I have no chips in the pot as far as Nikon or Canon or Olympus or Minolta. All I care about is the picture. Show me the picture and I'll talk about the picture. I don't care what you made it with. A bunch of my best friends use Nikon. So I do know from meeting lots of people and lots of bird photographers in the last 33 years, that almost to a man, Nikon people hate the 2Xs. The last one that they made, I've only heard a few good things about it, but most people just say it's terrible. And they have been for many decades, but again, I've never used one, so I don't know. So I have the 2X and the 1.4, and in between I have a 12 millimeter extension tube. Now, extension tubes are generally used so you can get a little bit closer to your subject. The new lenses, the 600 and the 502, the close focus is so good. One is under 15 feet and the other is like 16 and a half that I barely use the one of my extension tubes. I don't even take the 25 millimeter into the field, but I just use it as a separator so I can have the two of them together rather than have to deal with four caps. So if I want to put my 2X on, I will grab it, and the very first thing that I will do is to shut off the camera, because by shutting off the camera, you're going to reduce the dust spotting. Changing lens is not a good idea. So you see that we have this pretty nicely balanced. The tripod is an Enduro. After using Gitzo for 31 years, I finally, their customer service and their pro relations finally just went to such hell in a handbasket that I said, I need to find a tripod that's at least as good. And I wound up going to Enduro. The thing is not just as good, it's better. This one has been in salt water like 68 times. I slightly screwed up last week by washing the sand off and taking everything apart and making the mistake of putting soap on the threads, thinking I was doing something good. But I had a lot of problem. This one right now is stuck and you have to really pound on it to move it. But
how about some lockies?
I'm sorry?
Lockies.
All I need to do is get it home and give it to Jim. Say, Jim, put this in the tub and scrub it down good and make it better. And if not, I'll send it in. But it's been fantastic. And the best part is they cost about a third less than Gitzo, probably even a little more than a third less. The top of the lines are like $550, $600 for the really tall one. And the Gitzo's just, as their customer service has gotten worse and worse, I would take my tripod in salt water, my Gitzo, and I'd have one anodized leg, and I'd send in an $850 tripod. And if they did deign to fix it, I get a bill for $675. So it just got to the point of ridiculousness. So I wound up with Enduro, and yeah, if you best thing, we're gonna show you how to email me from the blog if you have a question, because the big deal with tripods is height. You wanna get the right model for your height. So shoot me an email and we'll get you set up with the right one. So I've turned the camera off and I'm gonna put my 2X on. I'm gonna tighten the lens rotation. Oh, forgot this. This is the Mongoose M3.6. Best news for me is you cannot buy this at B&H. I've been using this about 12 or 13 years. They originally had a smaller one that was great for the intermediate telephotos, but they quit making that. And they had about four different iterations of this, and now it's really close to perfect. It replaces the Wimberly head that I used for 20 years. It weighs about less than half of the Wimberly head, and you'll see the photographs. I make sharp pictures with it, and we're gonna talk about how I do that in a minute. So, I'll just snug up the vertical and horizontal pans, and I will tighten this, and I will take the 2X, and I'll make sure the camera's off, and I'll hold my hand there in case I forgot anything, put it on, and you'll notice now that my lens that was so nicely balanced is now way back heavy. So every time that I add or subtract the teleconverter to the mix, I'm gonna rebalance the rig. And what I like to do is simply hold my shoulder against it, lift up the clamp, go to about where I think, and you know, after 33 years, you get a pretty good idea of where the balance points are. Some anal retentive people put little marks on their plates. Not me. So, now the question is, we've just gone from 600 millimeters to 1200 millimeters. So, while the size of the subject in the frame by adding a doubler is increased four times, because how much area it covers is a function of the square of the focal length. So your subject's gonna be four times bigger. So that's the great news. The bad news is that you just lost two stops of light. Your F4 lens becomes an F11 lens. Second bad news is, just as the size of the subject is increased by the square of the focal length, lens shake and your errors, your failure to keep the lens still are also multiplied by four. So you really need to keep the lens still. And the basic stuff I'm gonna show you right now is in the section on advanced sharpness techniques in the CD book, which was the follow-up to the original The Art of Bird Photography, and we'll talk a little bit about that later. And basically, if I'm standing, what I'm gonna do is put my hand here. Now, some people with a mongoose with shorter arms will put their hand here. I just love that I can get it here and brace my forearm against here. And the next thing I'm gonna do is put the back of my face. I shoot with my left eye. Don't ask me why. I've just been doing it since when I first picked up a camera. But I am gonna press my face against the back of the camera. And I'm sort of gonna put a little torque on this. And of course, if I have a static subject, the bird's just sitting on a perch, it's in one place. If I can, I will take the time to lock the vertical and horizontal pans and then still further steady the lens. But in general, you want to be having a little bit of tension on the lens so you can move it if the bird starts to walk slowly. And again, back of the face against the camera, forearm on the tripod, and then holding the lens from below. For years, people were teaching you to do this, and I used to teach the same thing. And I just find that making much sharper images by getting your hand below. What's the exact reason in physics? I don't know. When it comes to shorter lenses, this is the new, oops, almost took off my microphone. This is the new 100 to 400-2 that I absolutely love and adore, mostly for its close focus. You can actually stand here and photograph your toenail. So, quite impressive. I'm gonna give you those for a second. Again, camera off. And one of the things, I love the Wimberly P20 plate on here, but I put it on backwards for better balance. But there are times, like right now, when I need to loosen the tripod collar so I can get that off. Once I put this on, that's not a problem. So this is the 100 to 400 with the 1.4 teleconverter, as you will see right in the beginning of the program, once we get to the slides, you're limited with most camera bodies to only the central AF point plus the four assist points. But with the 1D Mark II, which is actually this body, you get all the autofocus points. I knew that they could have done that with every camera for the last 10 years, and they never did. They made it a big deal. And Canon, I think, said, well, it might not work that great, so we're not gonna give them to you. But now they have with the 1DX Mark II. This is a 5DSR that I use for the majority of my bird photography. And a lot of people are amazed by that. How could you use a 5DSR when you own a 1DX Mark II? Well, the 1DX Mark II offers the world's best autofocus system, at least for Canon. It offers really good high ISO control. And it offers the 14 frames per second. This thing, the 5DSR, offers image files that when you look at them, they're not like anything you've ever seen. You take a good sharp one and you blow it up to 100% and you can see every barbule on every feather. It's really not like it. It blows the 1DX Mark II away. So I find I own two of these and one of them. So which one do I like better? I don't use this a lot with the teleconverter, but I don't hesitate to. We're going to see some examples in the program. And how many people own a 7D Mark II? Okay. I own two of them for a year and a half or so, and I use them a lot. And then I went to the 5DSR saying, hey, I lose the 1.6 crop factor, but if I take these files and I crop to the same size as 72, I'm gonna have more pixels and much more detail. But I still say that the 7D Mark II is the greatest value ever in a digital camera body. But what people gotta understand, and I've had arguments with all the technical geniuses, of which I am not anywhere close to technical, my technical knowledge is poor. But I knew from the time I picked up a 7D Mark II, and then when I went to the 5DSR, I knew that I had to keep those lenses stiller than when I was using a full frame camera with bigger pixels, like a Mark IV, a 1D Mark IV, or a 5D Mark II. And everybody told me, no, you're wrong. The amount of shake, first with the, no, it's wrong, you're wrong. The shake is the same, whatever you're using. And then my friend Alan Lillick, who's a really smart guy, he said, no, there's more shake across the pixel level. So you're right. I mean, I knew I was right because I was seeing it in my pictures, you know, in terms of motion blur or lens shake, that your errors were magnified by this incredible resolution. So let's go to hand holding for a minute. I have a bunch of friends who pride themselves on being able to handhold the 600 for flight. A lot of them use the 600. Now the Model 2 600 is a good couple of pounds lighter than the older 500. And a lot of them will use the 600 with a 1.4 teleconverter for flight beyond me. And my friend Patrick Sparkman, you've seen some of his stuff on the blog, he handholds the 600 with the 2X all the time. So he's always trying to do something to steady the lens. So if you're seated, what you're doing is getting one knee up, getting your forearm on the left, and coming here. And one thing that you always want to try to do when you're hand holding is to have autofocus active at the moment of exposure. In other words, get a sensor, get an AF point somewhere on the bird so that AF is active. If you go to one shot AF and you're hand holding and you're pushing the shutter button half press to focus, and then holding on for a second or two, you're breathing. I can't stand still for a second, but all of this motion is going to throw autofocus off. So you want to be an AI servo and have a sensor on the bird. And even if you're using rear focus, you want to have the rear focus button pushed in. And that will make sure that you're not going to get any errors in focusing, because you set focused and then moved or breathed or the bird moved slightly. Some of these guys that do handhold the big lenses, and I actually think I have two pictures in this program that were taken with the 600 and the 2X. One, I was laying on the ground and I built a little sand pile for the back of my left hand and shot it like this. And the other one, and this is the big trick, what they try to do is, like an Olympic rifle shooter, these guys are hand holding these 22 pound rifles, not by trying to do this, which for me, facing the subject and just trying to hold the lens out like I just did for 1 second like this, my elbow is just trash, but face sideways to the subject, put your elbow in, lean back a little bit, and I have made a few sharp pictures. Works much better with the 1.4 and the 600 alone, but I am not a big fan of hand-holding the big glass. Then when you get down to the 300 2.8 and the 400 DOs, you have a chance, depending on your strength and your hand-eye coordination, both of which of mine have seen much better days as I just passed my 70th birthday. Anyway, I think I'm gonna shut up and start sharing some photographs using teleconverters, what I do best. The 7800 2.8, there's been a few iterations going back to a non-IS1 and then an IS and then an IS2. tremendously versatile lens, great for landscapes. Those of you who visit the blog have seen lots of pictures of my granddaughter Maya dancing, always with the 70 to 200 2.8. Here it is with the 1.4 teleconverter in Galapagos. So these shorter lenses, the 100 to 400 2 and the 70 to 200 are great when you're going to places where the birds are really tame. Like Midway, totally closed to visitation. I was privileged to be up there 3 times. This is a backlit baby Laysan albatross with a 70 200 and the 1.4. Same rig taking off down the runway. In Iceland, 70 200 1.4 at about 120 millimeters or 150 millimeters. So a lot of people will say, well, wait a second, Artie, you have a 70 200 f4, a 70 200 2.8, you have a 1.4 teleconverter on it. Why are you taking a picture at 160 millimeters? You could have just left the teleconverter off and gotten a slightly sharper image and had more light. I say, yeah, but you add the teleconverter. Sometimes you zoom out to get the whole bird, and sometimes you zoom in to show tight details, get a head portrait, whatever. And what I did here, the other factor, whether you have an intermediate telephoto lens with a teleconverter or big glass, is the human zoom-in factor, moving back or moving closer. So here we had this beautiful bird on this little pedestal of grass, and I wanted to get a head portrait. And I had about 7 folks with me, and I said, oh my God, if I scare this bird off the perch, they're gonna push me over the cliff, and rightfully so. But I got in. It's funny, I may fall down 3 times during the course of this program. So it seems my balance is not as good as it was a million times from 10 or 20 years ago. And I'm clumsy, I injure myself in the house routinely, pretty much almost on a daily basis, I bounce. But if you put me in the field with a big lens, with or without a tripod, I'm gonna get as close to that bird without disturbing it as anybody in the world. And if you're on a bird and I know you and I wanna get close, I will get behind you, and I've done this 1,000 times in my career, where somebody would be on a bird. I would never do this with somebody I didn't know without asking. And then I will approach the bird, and then I will sit down behind them, and they will turn around and go, what are you doing? How'd you get there? So I'm stealthy when it comes to being around birds. Being around beanbags, not so stealthy. 70-200 a Gatorland with flash, high key, great for flight, zooming out here probably to, with the teleconverter, to about 160 or 70 millimeters. And in the Southern Ocean, King Penguin for abstracts, you sit on the ground and they come right up to you. This is the King Penguin, relative of the Emperor Penguin we talked about. And I am going back to South Georgia with the Cheesemans on their last trip. I signed up about between 45 and 50 people. That's a good thing for me. And I'm also gonna be in the Falklands twice, and I'm gonna be in South America for 10 weeks. So it will be exciting. This one is a 16 to 35 millimeter shot. I'm carrying short lenses, usually the 24 to 105, and this is just an amazing scene. I had hiked up some mountain over there, and we were doing Gentoo penguin colonies, and a bunch of people said to me, Artie, you gotta get in the next Zodiac and go around the corner to this cove. It's amazing. You've never seen anything like it. There were thousands of penguins, and people took a GoPro, and they stuck it in the water. And for every penguin on the surface, there were like 20 fishing below the surface. And because they put the GoPro in upside down, when you see it on the computer, it looks like 1,000 rockets taking off. It was amazing footage. Anyway, there was a grounded iceberg, and the Gentoos were on the iceberg, and they were jumping off the iceberg to join the fishing party, and then they would jump back up, and half of them would get chin strapped. They would hit their necks into the ice and fall back in the water. It took 1,000 pictures, and this one is my favorite. Flying penguin with the 70 Mark II and the 7200 with a 1.4 teleconverter. So as much as I love the 5DSR, I've had this and maybe half a dozen other pictures taken with the 70 Mark II that were held for the final rounds of BBC and Nature's Best Contest. So it's a great camera. Once in a while, and again, there's a lot of people who just use this, they won't even buy the 100 to 400 because they make such good pictures with the 70 to 200 2.8 and the 2X. This is on a tripod down in the Falklands, feeding squid, a Gentoo penguin feeding squid, and then a Gatorland 7200 for flight with the beautiful breeding plumage snowy egret. The 100 to 400 that we just took a look at, I don't think I might have used the teleconverter with the old 1 to 400 once or twice. At that time, none of the cameras focused even to F8, which meant if you put the 1.4 on, you needed to focus manually. And as soon as you got to focus manually, you must be on a tripod and the bird must be still. But again, quite a viable combination. This is the 100 to 400 on a tripod with a 1.4 teleconverter. Minimum focus distance is a ridiculous, was it 0.9 meters? Oh, it doesn't even say it on here. No, I think it's 0.9 meters, less than 3 feet, which is why you can focus on your toe. Amazing close focus. And this flower is only about this big. So the center, what we're looking at, is about this big. So it's really like having a quasi-macro lens. In San Diego, in bright sun, the 100 to 400 with the teleconverter. And to give you an idea of what I mean, with every Canon camera, the modern ones, they focus to F8, but you get only the middle sensor plus the 4 assist points. So all of those other sensors on a 5D Mark II, a 7D Mark II, they're not available. So when you're at F8, you just get the middle sensor. With the new camera, the 1DX Mark II, this one, I get all the sensors. But, you know, as I did here, you can work around the shoot at F8, have enough depth of field to cover the eye. And you could see, for people who use DPP, which you should if you're doing Canon, you see that the red square is illuminated. That's telling you that AF was active at the moment of exposure. So if I was using rear focus, it meant I was pushing and holding the focus button. And if I'm using shutter button, that I was pushing the shutter button and holding it halfway. As opposed to using rear focus and then recomposing, then the box in the middle will not be illuminated. One of the things that's sort of unfortunate with Canon is when you're in these situations where you have the middle sensor and the 4 assist points or the 8 assist points, with autofocus active at the moment of exposure, they will never tell you which AF point was active when you took the picture. It'll do that if you're in 61 point or 65 point or middle zone. That's where it goes, dancing around. And the raw file will show you which points were active. But when you're limited to F8 with the older cameras, it'll light up the middle one regardless of which one was active when you took the picture. Boy, when I first got the 1DX II, I was at the Soto on a cloudy morning, and I said, I think this is about ISO 8000 or something ridiculous, and the photograph's beautiful. And it's, again, at F8. Which will mean that I put the sensor somewhere over here to get a sharp photograph. And then, inspired by one of the kids on my trip, Liberty Ranger, I can't remember his name, Bill, he was shooting flight with the 100 to 400 and the 1.4, so I said, well, I could try it. and there's a sandwich turn diving. And I did the same thing in Scotland and the UK on our puffins trip, hand holding, because so much easier to hand hold this for flight than to use a big lens on a tripod or even the 400DO, which gets heavy after a while. Part of the same little setup. Now, we saw that the 100 to 400 with a 1.4 teleconverter, we only had the middle sensor at F8. What happens with any Canon camera when you go to F11? No autofocus. F8, they focus to F8. So you don't get any autofocus, but once in a while, I'll use the 100 to 400 with the 2X. And I'll manually focus. And I took a whole series. This animal was sleeping under a tree, not sleeping, but resting on, what's the island? South Plaza in Galapagos, where the land iguanas are rife. And everybody was photographing these animals in the sun. And I said, no, the light's too bright. Do that one in the shade. And I didn't have enough reach. So I went to that with the 1.4. With the 2X, and focus manually. And boy, just looking at that eye through the viewfinder, when that thing focuses, it's perfect. And I think almost every picture that I took was super sharp. Now, this lens, the 200 to 400 F4 LIS with the built-in teleconverter, which I still own and don't use all that much, the price of that lens and that lens got super hurt when they came out with the 100 to 400 too. Because people are going, most properly, well, it's digital, I have a higher ISO, so if I use this lens and I go one ISO higher, and this lens cost $2,400, and this lens cost $12,000, and that lens heavier. So a lot of folks have been selling them. We have one or two on the used gear page on my site, and they're selling ridiculous cheap. Anyway, amazing lens. It's got the built-in TC. All the pictures I'll show you were with the internal TC engaged to start. In other words, not between 200 and 400, but between 280 and 560 millimeters. Oh, that is a white cheek pintail from the Galapagos. And I had one pair of boots with me on the Galapagos. And I was wearing them. And these birds were displaying in this muddy pond. And I said, I don't care. And I just walked slowly right into the mud and got close enough and made a beautiful photograph of this guy displaying. With the 200 to 400 at 400 with the 1.4, 560 millimeters. And then struggling for me to hand hold it from the Zodiac at sunset. And again, struggling from, this might have been on a tripod, red-billed tropic bird on Hood Island in the afternoons. How many people have ever been to the Palouse? Amazing, beautiful place with rolling farmlands. So I love the 200 to 400. A lot of people come with just maybe a 300 or a 70, and I'm going, I want the reach to just stack all those elements up. And the beautiful wind turbine. One guy came on the trip last year and said, I want to get close to the wind turbines. I said, I got a spot where you could pet them. He goes, no, you can't get anywhere near them. I said, just make sure you don't sleep late tomorrow. So we went out, and you could actually touch a wind turbine if you wanted. So we've done a lot of searching, and we wound up somewhere on this road that went up and up, and all the wind turbines you want. And my vision for the Palouse is to go tight on the details and get for this tight, dramatic stuff with impact. This is a barn in early morning light, just the roof. And little lawn ornaments. I did a whole series of these cows. Again, 560 millimeters. And 560 millimeters, this is an amazing gas station. The guy moved the whole gas station onto his property and then populated with all kinds of old cars and trucks. And this is a Cadillac police car, about 1930s. So again, my style is not to do the whole car, but to zoom in, use long focal lengths, and try to tell the same story that somebody else might be telling with a 24 to 105. Now, what's nice about the 2-4 with the internal extender is you can pop a second teleconverter onto the back, which will really give you equivalent of having a doubler, but it's actually a little bit sharper. And this was from Japan in winter on the Eagle boat, and even closer on the tripod at 784 millimeters. 560 times 1.4. And even in the Palouse, there's a lot of private property. I wanted to do some vertical pan blurs, so I went to 784, the 2-4 with another 1.4 teleconverter. The 300 2/8, they made an old one that was super sharp, and then make a new one, a version 2. I bought it, and I used it quite a bit. I love it with the 1.4 teleconverter, it's killer. I brought it to the Southern Ocean. This was in South Georgia. And in the Falklands at New Island, black-browed albatross courting. And a nice close focus. Forget what, they have a bunch of names for these guys. It's a cormorant or shag. I think this one might be blue-eyed. And that was in the Falklands. And a little coffee clutch with the 70 to 200, with the 300 and the 1.4. And again, lots of tame birds. And a nice close focus on the new 300. Not as good as the 100 to 400, but still with the teleconverter, lots of reach for this iris. This is a rear focus and recompose. Japan in winter with Stellar Seagull at sunrise, and Russia in the background. And then hand-holding the 300 and the 1.4 at a slow shutter speed, a pleasing blur, landing Sea Eagle, and Japanese Red Crown Crane. And I have a trip in February of 17. We have, I think, three openings. And the coolest part is that our lodge is right behind these trees at Tsuro Ito Crane Sanctuary. 300 F2.8 version 2 with a 1.4 teleconverter. It's a roseate turn, photographed at Great Gull Island Project, which is in the Long Island Sound between Niantic, Connecticut, and Orion Point, and where my daughter Jennifer was working as a researcher when she met her husband Eric. And common tern at the same location. And then I started experimenting with the 300 and the 2X. Handheld, relatively light. In Ushuaia, Argentina, before we got on the ship at Tierra del Fuego National Park, we went on a walk with no guarantees. Everybody wanted to see Magellanic woodpecker. For a lot of people, it's a holy grail species. And we saw the birds, and they flew right down to us at one point, and then they flew away. We had a big group. So everybody said, oh, that's great. And there was another couple I became good friends with. Zorica, how are you, Zorica? She's from California, and her husband is surgeon. And they said, oh, that was great. I said, that wasn't great. We didn't get any pictures. And the birds came down on the ground to chop up the rotted tree. So all these people are happy that they saw it, but we're gonna do better. So everybody went off looking for some other species, and we stayed with the birds and got fabulous stuff. Black-browed albatross with the beautiful pink on the base of the bill, all with the 300 and the 2.8, so it's like having a hand-holdable 600. And when I go to Galapagos, or when I go to the Southern Ocean, pretty much the last few years, I left the 500 and the 600 at home, because the birds are just so tame and inquisitive as well, that you can get tight stuff with either 420. For a while I did the 300, and now on this year I'm bringing the 400 2.8. Excuse me, the 400 F4DO. We'll see that in a moment. From the Zodiac with my good friend Joe Kaplan driving, handheld 600 millimeter lens. Scotland, actually the UK. And then the 400DO. The 400DO, the old one. Oh, the internet experts love to trash that lens. Oh, it's the worst lens. There's no contrast. It's not sharp. In the meantime, I made pictures that won both contests, honored in Nature's Best and National Wildlife in the same year. Tons of great stuff that I sold and sold. And now the new one, the 400 F4DO2, is even sharper. So this is made with a variety. That's with the new one and a 1.4 teleconverter. Handheld, this guy was sitting on the railing at Gatorland. So when you have these lenses, like a 300 or a 400, one of the huge advantages of being able to handhold is that you're more mobile. You can get to a place faster. You can lean over the railing, stuff that you couldn't do with a 600. Get the lens where it needs to be. Hand holding at Lake Blue Cypress on a white sky day. And then in capital of Falklands, Stanley in the Falklands. We do, as part of our land-based Falkland trips, I do a day with rockhopper penguins. We get in a van and they take us out to this cool rookery. And the lady said to us, "Oh, there's a Moseley's penguin." So what's that? "Oh, it's a race of rockhopper that has much shaggier head." So we found the bird. We photographed it. It was an amazing bird with the plumes just out to here. And then when we got on the ship, again, my friend Joe Kaplan said, "Well, congratulations. That used to be a subspecies. It's a new species. They just split it from northern rockhopper to Moseley's penguin." And the 400DO, this is from this year, up in Northumberland on the Puffins and Gannets IPT. And from the Falklands, staying back and getting a little closer and then moving up and getting a single bird coming out of the water in early morning light. 400DO, the 1.4 teleconverter, and with that lens, with every camera, you're gonna be able to get all the sensors with a 1.4 teleconverter. With the 2X, you'll just get the middle unless you have the new camera. 400DO and a teleconverter. The new one, sandwich turn. This was down on our DeSoto IPT. And then the great challenge is getting on them, phew, and then trying, you know, for every one like this, you'll get 100 with half the bird cut off or not in the frame at all. An old one with the old 400DO and a 40D. Great camera. A lot of people say, "Oh, I'm going to buy a 7D because I don't have much money." I said, "Listen, stay away from those tiny pixels. Try to get yourself a used 40D or a used 50D for half the money, twice the camera." 400DO with a teleconverter. The Isle of May. And just recently at Nickerson, 400DO, 1DX Mark II with a teleconverter, battling skimmers. And early morning, I love to do the blurs. had a group of skimmers, and one was taking off to join the others, and I had a few chances, and I liked this one and one other. Finally, the 400DO with the 2X, and again, I have friends who are younger that absolutely kill shooting terns in the dark and peregrine falcons with the 2X, and I'm like, I can't even get the bird in the frame. So if you, in the next week or two in the blog, I'm going to publish my friend Arash Hazegi. He's a moderator on birdphotographers.net. He's an avian moderator, and he's amazing with this combination. Shoots peregrines in the dark, like jet planes, getting them sharp, amazing stuff. I'm gonna publish his in the field review, probably in 3 or 4 days, with amazing photographs. ISO 10,000, turn with a fish, peregrines upside down, and the title is gonna be Point. It's gonna be Arash's photographs with his review, about 4 or 5 photographs. The next day it's gonna be Counterpoint. It's gonna be pictures that I made with the 1DX Mark II, where I have the sensor right on the subject, and the bird's not even close to being in focus. So people write in the blog every day and they say, well, how can you have a thing where the sensor's right on the bird and it's not in focus? Well, it's called operator error. Number one, autofocus needs contrast to see. So if it's really low light, it's very hard for the camera to grab onto anything. Secondly, you need to get the lens and the AF point on the subject, push the button, and it takes a second or two to find the subject and then start to track it. So if you're the operator and you just jerk the lens and push the button and the sensor happens to be on the bird's face, but you haven't given the system enough time to track, yeah, it's not going to be in focus. But the point I want to make with these two blog posts is don't go out and buy a 1DX Mark II and a 400DO and think you're gonna make pictures like Arash the next day. You know, it's not the lens, it's not the camera. It's what's here and here and practice. 400DO2 on a tripod in the Galapagos, short-eared owl with Galapagos storm petrel. They wait by the entrance to the burrows in broad daylight, and when the petrels come out, whack, they grab them. This one was amazing. 400DO2, 2X and 7D2. It's about 8,000 millimeters from a rocking Zodiac. And I got one in the frame in sharp, which was a miracle. Galapagos penguin. Rock shag on the Falklands, on Bleecker Island. And not rockhopper, but macaroni penguin. And for the longtime followers of the blog, they know that about 3 years ago, we got to this landing spot and my knee was bothering me and it was snowing. And I said, you know what? There's 2 weeks more to the trip. The last thing I want to do is fall and miss the rest of the trip. So everybody made the landing but me. And then they came back and I was sick. Because the first time I had made that landing, we walked about a mile up and hills and then down. So that's what I was scared of. They got back on the ship, everybody said, we walked up 75 yards and there were 300 macaroni penguins playing in the snow. So I did a blog post, you snooze, you lose. And I published the pictures of my friends. And then last year, this was Artie's redemption. It's a lot of fun laying in the snow with the big lens in fresh snow at Fortuna Bay. All the time we have fresh snow there. And in San Diego, a double-crested cormorant. The western birds have the white our birds have black and they don't really display as much. Breeding plumage sanderling from last May, 400 DO, 2X, high ISO, like ISO 5000 with the 1DX2. And most recently, we put an add-on day on the Puffins trip where we landed on Bass Rock. So I've done gannets so many times in Quebec, and it was very muddy that I went after the herring gull chicks. We talked a little bit before the program about the old 800 millimeter 5.6 lens. Great big long lens, f5.6, focuses to about 19 feet. Great alone, and again, with all the cameras at that time when the 800 was around, you only got the middle sensor plus four when you use the teleconverter. But it was still a great combination from Bolsa Chica, Whistling Duck in Florida, up near Homer, Bald Eagle Talons, in New Mexico with the 2X, with the 1.4. So that's giving you 1120 millimeters. So with the 800, part of the problem was you have the 800 and then you have 1120. So you really only have two focal lengths. Well, you'll see where I'm going in a minute. This is Bearded Mannequin from Trinidad with flash, and some little Hummer from Trinidad, the 800 and a 1.4. From the Eagle Boat, Slaty Back Gull. And one of the neat things, natural history-wise, is that a really good birder can identify pretty much every species of gull in the world in breeding plumage by the color of the eye skin. Everyone is slightly different. This one matches your shirt. Red crown crane sleeping with his wing over his head. And a nice tight head portrait. Whoops. Now when you have the 800 5.6 and you go to the 2X, you're at F11 again, manual focus. I wanted to get this group. And anybody know what really ticks me off about this one? One bird. Which one? The front one. So those of you who visit the blog or take part in birdphotographers.net, I'm the captain of the head angle police. So what we generally want is the bird either square to the camera, generally even better about 2 or 3 degrees towards. But once they're turned away, so what I should have done, could have done, was taken this head, but it wouldn't have been the right focus. Maybe this guy. I didn't know how to do that then, but that wouldn't be too difficult. Head replacement surgery. Before I owned the 800, and after I owned my first 600, and the old 600s before the version 2s were really up there, like 13 and a half pounds, at one point I decided to buy the 500 F4, the old one, and save a couple of pounds, and then I graduated to the 500 F4, the new one, then I sold that and bought it again. So now I own both, the 5 and the 6, but I don't own the 8. But the 500 and the 1.4 is a deadly combination. Oh, one of my favorite pictures of all time. This is a semi-palmated, there's the semi-palmation, a little webbing between the toes, a little baby about 2 days old with Papa, semi-palmated sandpiper up in Nome, Alaska, and the flower is beach pea. And I remember the father was running around and the baby, we were just standing there, and I said, geez, there's only one place I could get a shot, so I moved to the left, trying to shoot through this slot, and I was there about a minute, and miraculously, as if I just willed them, the adult stood there for a second, and then the baby stood there for half a second, and I made two frames at an 80th of a second. In Africa, a lot easier to travel long distances with a 500 than a 600 in terms of weight and size and getting on a plane. And my first trip down to Antarctica, I brought the 500. Everybody told me I was crazy. You don't need it. And I've sort of come back to their point. But when I first started showing these pictures, people were saying, oh, maybe I will bring my 500. It's a baby Adélie penguin in a snowfall. Inca tern in Chile with the 500 and the 1.4. Western gull, dime a dozen, out in San Diego. Oh, one that I tried for years, elegant tern. Looks like a royal tern. It's got a longer, slimmer bill and a fancier hairdo. That was this winter. And that was up in Morro Bay. 500 and 1.4 and probably an extension tube to get a little bit closer. Anna's hummingbird.
How close were you?
That was the new 500, so 17, 16 feet, 15 feet, 14 and a half feet. One of the good lessons is shoot now, ask questions later. If you see something happening or somebody calls something out, try to get focus and push the button. If you go, well, I'm only at a 3/20th of a second, I should be at least a 12/50th.
It's gone.
It's way gone. So somebody called out, incoming bald eagle. And I didn't even give a thought to the shutter speed. It was at 1/320th of a second. I got on it, one frame sharp, bird frozen, nice blur to the wingtips. So don't try to think, what am I gonna do? You know, take the picture and worry about it later. I bought the 500 a bunch of times up onto the bear boat, here with a 1.4 teleconverter, a little cub. I have a trip in July of 17 where we're going specifically on the perfect week to get the little football-sized cubs, we hope. This was Mr. Huffer. We were laying on the ground and this bear came walking down the stream, and every time he would walk by a big bear, he'd go, hur, hur, hur. Boy, that bear is a brave bear for being a little bear. And then he would actually go up to them and pick a fight with them. And one time he ran out to chase a bald eagle, and he ran right by a big male bear who then proceeded to chase him for 2 miles down the beach to the limit of what we could see. And then the next morning, there was little Mr. Huffer bothering another big old male bear. So the lesson that I said was, hey, I don't want to be around in 3 or 4 years when he comes back at 650 pounds. The 500 with the 2X, piece of cake, little bear fight, little lunch. Galapagos penguin. I'm sorry, geez. My brain is going, wait a second. How did I shoot a Galapagos penguin with the 500 and the 2X? I would never bring it in a Zodiac. I might bring the 500, but not with the 2X. And then I realized that it is not a Galapagos penguin. It is a, from the Falklands, Magellanic. It practically looks like the same bird in a different place. A baby brown pelican in the nest. This was at, how many people have been to Fort DeSoto? When you go over the bridge and you come to the last 7-Eleven on the left, there's a little island where frigate birds roost. We went out there by boat and got some baby pelicans in the nest. White ibis, 1,000 millimeters at Fort DeSoto. And this year, I went to San Diego for my usual San Diego pelican tour. One of the pleasures of being in San Diego was that the Brandt's cormorants were setting up nests right next to this fence in La Jolla, 20 feet away. So you'll see some more pictures in the afternoon show. This is a Brandt's cormorant, 500 and 2X, doing gular panting, like your dog would pant to keep cool. And more of the same with the spotlight side-lit effect. So about this point, you might be saying, man, I tried to use my 2X with my 500, and the pictures weren't even close to being sharp. What is this guy doing? Yeah, I know, hold the lens still. One of the things that I've done for about the last decade with my big lenses and teleconverters is to micro-adjust them using the lens align kit and some amazing software called Focus Tune. It's a pain. It can be frustrating when you're first trying to learn it. We're working on a new simplified tutorial, which ain't gonna be that simple, but simpler than the last two. Anyway, I should have put this picture in the program, I didn't. Was in Namibia at this place with flamingos, and we saw this beautiful little, I think, white-breasted plover chick. I got on the ground with the 600 and the 2X, and I thought I killed the thing, meaning got a great picture, and I got the pictures back, and they were razor sharp on the legs, and the bird's face was totally out of focus. And I realized that I had switched my 5DSRs. And I wound up using the 5DSR that was not micro-adjusted with the 2X and the 600. So then I tested that combination, and it needed minus 18. So the focus had to be pulled forward about an inch and a half. So that was a costly lesson. So everything's micro-adjusted. The 600 and the 1.4 is a piece of cake. Fort DeSoto. With the 7D too, so that tells you that bird's a good distance off. Rosie at Spoonville. Gatorland. Ah. You'll see some pictures in a second, yeah, of the great egrets with their beautiful green lures. They keep that about a week. The birds, when they're nesting and they're actively engaged in being around a breeding colony and courtship, they get the beautiful enhanced colors of their lures, that skin in front of the eye. And on great egret, the colors last about a week. And each one's a little different. With snowy egret, that color lasts about a day and a half. So I'll go to St. Augustine, and I'll see a bird that looks pretty good, and I'll say, come back tomorrow, and people think I'm joshing, and go back, and the bird is just looks like this one. And then you go the next day, and it's already fading. So they hold that red just for a second. So I love being headhunter. I did an article for Wild Bird magazine, headhunter. I love getting in tight, showing the amazing detail. Look at the head angle on each one. Remember I said square is good, but 1 to 3 degrees towards you is better. Puts the bill tip on the same plane as the eye. Gives you better light on the face. In soft light, that's Gatorland. And Gatorland with the black background. Actually, there was, how many people saw yesterday's blog? Black ground. Oh, shame on everyone. Western gull in early morning light. I got tall, so I was able to get the shaded cliff as background. Don't know if it's in this show or the next one, but. Ross's gull, 600 in the 1.4, moving really slowly, and really slowly getting up on a snow goose in New Mexico. Same combination at the Crane Ponds in evening, and an old, old blur with the 600. You know what, am I messed up? Yeah, 600 in the 1.4, my bad. 600 in the 1.4. In Japan in winter, one of the great advantages of being in our lodge is that if it snows really heavily, no one can get there except us. We just have a quarter mile down the hill. Incredible trip. Inner farns, and I love that combination for the murres, a common murre with fish, and two cording, and razorbills cording. I said to the group, everybody was to my right, and we were down in this little cutout, and I said, these guys are gonna copulate within 2 minutes. And they were cording and kissing up, and I was all the way on the left, and everybody was to my right. And I said, there they go. And just as the male hopped up, I got photobombed by another bird that landed right in front between me and them, and everybody to my right got the shot. Sitting on the ground at Nickerson and getting up early at Nickerson. Oh, this was one from this year, beautiful. 600, 1, 4, and 5 DSR, a baby oyster catcher, unbanded, like every oyster catcher chick out there is banded. Same bird, about a week later, getting fed a sand flea, my mama. And then finally, my current WMD, weapon of mass destruction, the 600 and the 2X. When people say, how do you do it? I say, listen, I go out, I hold the lens still, I focus, I push the button. I've practiced. I keep the lens still. I press my face against. I try to dampen the lens with my body. And really, it's my favorite combination. It lends itself to my style. This is a super old one. 2002, 1D, 600 and 2X, red-throated loon from Nome. Shoveler from New Mexico. Screwing around in New Mexico with a half-second shutter speed, in the sun with a five-stop drop-in ND filter. Half-second exposure. One of the things I love, and I just wrote it in the blog yesterday, no, today, background, no, that was yesterday. One of the great things that I love about photography is trying to photograph a common subject, snow goose, 50,000 of them in New Mexico in winter, and do it in a way that's never been done before, to do something different. So here I was shooting the 600 and a 2X, manually focusing, setting the exposure at an 8,000th at 5.6, an 8,000th at f64. The sun is already up 20 minutes. I'm holding my thumb over the sun, not looking through the viewfinder, my hand on the shutter button, and when I see a goose about to fly into my thumbnail, I push the button. And I've already pre-focused about where the geese are flying. And then seeing this one on the back of the camera and jumping about 8 feet up. Love getting close. 2X, this was at the Soda. They had a colony set up for a couple of days and then they quit. A beautiful Wilson's plover nest. This one was fenced off, so the 2X gives me plenty of reach. Bird just sitting there. Another one from down in a sterile lagoon with a windy afternoon with the reflections of a yellow condo as the background. Fort DeSoto, semi-palmated plover. And that's one of my rare 600 2X handheld. And I was standing, doing it sideways, sandaling, bathing. On a tripod at Fort DeSoto, yellow crown black heron. Long, long effective focal length. 600, 2X, 70 Mark II. Do the math. 1200 times 1.6, 1800 and something. Keep it still. From the car near my home, ugly as a turkey vulture. And in tomorrow's blog, I'm going to raise a big stink. Audubon, Florida now wants to restrict a couple of bird colonies. So they're already restricted and roped off. Now they want you to be 3 miles away. Oh, the birds are so nervous around people. Yet at places like Gatorland in St. Augustine, the birds nest 10 feet away and could care less about people. See the blog. Beautiful reddish egret white morph in breeding plumage. Another nice snowy from Gatorland. Backlit cattle egret, my favorite. And this one is brand new. And a quick finishing up story. Took the picture. I used Photo Mechanic. I put a T for tag to keep them. This picture I added canvas left and top. So the autofocus sensor was on the bird's belly. I saw the thing jump, I focused, I raised the camera with the 2X, And it's sharp on the belly, but the head is really not sharp. So I did some extra sharpening on the bill and the eye. I did a couple of versions. I like this one the best. Is it perfect? No. Is it contest worthy? No. But it's cute as hell. And it's amazing. But the point is, because of my style, clean, tight, graphic, 1200 millimeters, 1000 millimeters, when something like this happens, I'm at a huge disadvantage. Huge. If I had had the 1.4 on, and I was on this bird, would have been a piece of cake to put the sensor on it and get every picture sharp. But with the 2X, in the sense, you know, I could have moved it up to his head, but who knew he was going to jump up in the air. But being tight, for clean, tight, and graphic, hurts you when it comes to action and behavior. Because a lot of times you're too clean, tight, and graphic for your own good. Then I was astounded when I got the 1DX Mark II on the Spring DeSoto IPT, where I was shooting this stuff with the 600 and the 2X and getting sharp stuff and even getting individual birds in flight with the 2X on a tripod, but I was still impressed by the 1DX Mark II. Old one, displaying ruddy duck. Yellow-headed blackbird, both of those from a trip to Montana. From Chile, black-necked swan with a chick. Torrent duckling from Torres del Paine. Or Piney del, Torres del Paine. I always get them mixed up. Silvery grebe on the nest, displaying against another bird that swam by. Also from Chile, and then from this year's Japan trip, spot-billed duck, Japanese mallard, but they have mallards too. And then rare for me on the tripod, 600 2X with a teleconverter, getting a sharp one. I don't do that often. On the puffin trip, fun, and more fun. And 2 years ago, we had a baby puffin swimming around in a puddle. Nobody could believe it. Because when they come out of the burrow, they go to the cliff and they jump in the sea. You never see a baby puffin. This one jumped and it wound up in this little pond. And they actually had to rescue it because they're programmed to think that once they're in the water, they're done. That's all there is. But he was just in the wrong water. A baby common murre, 1200 millimeters focal length, full frame 5DSR. From Namibia, Hartlaub's gull. Oh, I had 2 seconds on this bird. I was so happy. And in San Diego, we can get close. Heerman's gull. More from Nickerson Beach. You could be there by train and bus in like an hour and a half. Baby common tern. American oyster catcher on eggs. That's like a May shot. Adult skimmer with a feather on his bill. And a baby skimmer, adult skimmer juxtaposition. And this was the hand-holding one I was telling you about, where I built a little sand pile, rested my left hand, and then put the 600 in it. And most of them were not sharp. I shot a bunch at 1/60th of a second, 1/160th, and they were almost none sharp. But then I got up to a 500th, and I got sharp ones. Love that one. Late afternoon light, 1200 millimeters. And then finally back to your 1800 millimeters. Thank you to my friend Tom Pfeiffer, took me to this little colony on the North Shore. Adult male piping plover, 7D Mark II, 600 2X, 1800 millimeters and change, and sharp and beautiful image quality. Just to give you, this will be the last about 12 slide sequence, showing you how you use the different lenses in combination. Next to last time I was in Africa, I bought the 600 with the 2X and also the 100 to 400. Excuse me, the 200 to 400 with the built-in teleconverter. So right there, you're looking at like 24 grand. And I got my mongoose on a Todd pod, and I'm hand holding, and notice the sharpness deal there. Elbow on the roof of the van to give it that support rather than just hand holding it naked. And there's even better with the blub, which is a beanbag that I make, with my hand resting on the front of the blub, but doing everything I can. And notice, rear focus, autofocus, active at the moment of exposure. So when you're hand holding, you want to avoid one shot, and you want to avoid rear focus and recompose. You want to try to keep the sensor lit up and on the bird so that any motion doesn't wreck your shot. The beauty of the 200 to 400, zoom out and do this giraffe in habitat. And then, what can I say? I love bird photography. I'm diabetic, so I eat a special breakfast before we even leave the lodge, usually last night's dinner leftovers, protein and vegetables. So when we make a breakfast stop, and everybody's sitting at the breakfast table throwing crumbs to the birds, I'm sitting using the knee pod with the 200 to 400 with the teleconverter, photographing Usambara barbit. And this is a crazy one. 200 to 400 with the internal teleconverter, with an external teleconverter, 784 handheld flight of black-shouldered kite. Sometimes it works. A captive chameleon, a not captive civet, two different animals actually with the 200 to 400. One of the shrikes from the vehicle, lilac-breasted roller with a nice little leaf, high key, I love high key, and 560, oh no, that's the 600, I'm sorry. These two are the 600 and the 1.4. Now I've gone to the big guns. 600 and 1.4, 600 and 2X. Cheetah resting in the shade. Tiny little woodland kingfisher at 1,200 millimeters. And can't believe it. Almost last slide and I forgot the name. Black-headed heron coming into a colony. In flight with the 2X, it's rare that I get anything sharp. And a hyena just trucking. Ribs to go.
Oh my God.
We first saw this animal in the top of a tree with an impala, or one of the antelopes, and the whole group was so excited. I said, stop taking pictures, will you? I mean, the thing was buried between 10,000 branches. But it's a leopard, and it has a kill. I said, be patient, you're gonna delete them all. So I had no idea of what was coming, but we sat there, and after a while, the mother dragged the antelope right out onto this branch, right to that spot, and sat. Actually, I should have had the order reversed, because we photographed her with the 600 and the 1.4, and then I backed out once she was joined by the rest of the gang. So when things like that happen, you're just going like, is this as good as it gets? To come visit me, I don't have business cards, birds is art. I have a bunch of flyers left for those who'd like them can come up and grab one. And again, once you get to the blog, everything is interlinked. From the blog, you can go to the website. From the website, you can go to the blog. I urge you, if you enjoyed today's program, to subscribe to the blog. Tons of free information, every picture with the legendary captions, information on our Birds as Art instructional photo tours. Anyway, thank you for coming.
Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.